Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship here at West Kilbride Parish Church. Wherever you're joining us from, whether here in West Kilbride, further afield in Ayrshire, or all around the world, it's lovely to have you with us as we come and worship the Lord together. Just one or two intimations before we begin our service today. First of all, you'll have seen if you've been walking past the church building, you will have seen the Try Praying banner. And on the railings, you should see a wee box with some Try Praying booklets. And these are for non-Christians, really, those who would say they were not believers, to try praying for 7 days just to see what happens, because we believe that God speaks. Now, you're very welcome to take one yourself if you want one. But it does come with a caveat that you have to give it away after your time of prayer for 7 days, and you have to give it to someone who would not be a believer. So you can either take one from the church, or if you do want to get in touch with me, I've got plenty at the manse to just feel free to get in touch with me. Just some sad news that two of our members have sadly passed away. Nan McBride has sadly passed away, and her funeral is going to be on the 3rd of March. And Joan Kellick has also passed away, and her funeral is going to be on the 1st of March. So please do remember the families of Nan and Joan in your prayers. So let's come before the Lord in worship together. In our service today, we're going to be thinking about Jesus walking on the water. And Job says this about God: His wisdom is profound, his power is vast. Who has resisted him and come out unscathed? He moves mountains without their knowing it and overturns them in his anger. He shakes the earth from its place and makes its pillars tremble. He speaks to the sun and it does not shine. He seals off the light of the stars. He alone stretches out the heavens and treads on the waves of the sea. Let's begin our service together with a word of prayer. Let's pray together. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can draw near to you this day. And we thank you for that promise in your word that says when we draw near to you, then you in your mercy draw near to us. And Lord God, during this time, we need to know of your closeness. We need to know of your mercy. We need your forgiveness in our lives. We need to know hope, especially with what's happening in our world. And so we thank you that we can draw near to you this morning, that we can come to worship you, Almighty God. We thank you, Lord God, that you are the Lord over all, the one who holds all things in his hands. You are the one in whom we can trust. And with all the uncertainty in our world, where perhaps things threaten to overwhelm us, we thank you that we can trust that you're the God who's in control, that nothing surprises you. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a God of love. And it says in your word that you are love itself. And we pray that we might be people of love as we serve you in the place where you have set us, whether that's in West Kilbride or further abroad. And we ask that you would continue to be with us and that you would help us to be the ambassadors you've called us to be in our needy world. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can gather together this day, maybe not physically, but virtually, that we can come, that we can worship together, that we can sing your praises, that we can draw near to you in prayer, and we can learn from your word, which is an everlasting and eternal word. So, Father, go before us now, for we pray these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Come, people of the risen King, who delight to bring him praise. Come all and tune your hearts to sing to the morning star of grace. From the shifting shadows of the earth, we will lift our eyes to him, where steady arms of mercy reach.
mercies never cease, but follow us through all our days with a certain hope of peace. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice. Find the riches of His grace. Over all the world His people sing, shore to shore we hear them call. The truth that Christ through every age, our God is all in all. Rejoice.
Our reading this morning, continuing our series in Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 14 and verses 22 to 36. This is Jesus walking on the water. Let's hear the word of God. Immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It is a ghost," they said, and they cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." When they had crossed over, they landed at Gennesaret. And when the men of that place recognized Jesus, they sent word to all the surrounding country. People brought all who were ill to him and begged him to let those who were ill just touch the edge of his cloak, and all who touched it were healed. Amen. God will bless this reading from his holy word.
King of kings, majesty, God of heaven, strong deliverer, beginning and end. Oh, with many falls at your blood, your majesty, I can but bow. I lay my all before you now. In royal robes, I don't deserve.
Let's turn to God's word together as we see it again in Matthew 14 and verses 22 to 36. Once a month, our young people who are in Adventure Kids or in Accelerate have a Zoom call on a Sunday morning as they catch up and they recap some of the Sunday morning children's videos that we've made for them. And last Sunday, the young people had their Zoom call, and Shona and Rona, who were running the Zoom call, asked the young people what superpower they would like if they could have it. And so there were various answers as to what kind of superpower people would like. And some said that they would like to fly. Others said that they would like to have super strength. Others wanted a superpower to be invisible. And it's kind of fun to think, isn't it? What kind of superpowers that we would like to have if we were able. But one of the superpowers that I think would be really useful, but is rarely mentioned, would be the ability to walk on water. I think this would be a great superpower. You see, here we are in West Kilbride, and we can't be outside today. It's a wee bit cold and rainy, so we're here in the church. But maybe when you're out in your daily walk and you're down at the beach and you look across to the Isle of Arran, or you look across to Wee Cumbrae or Great Cumbrae, and you think, you know, it would be just great, wouldn't it, if I could just get on the water and just walk my way across to the other side. That would be brilliant, wouldn't it? Walk across to Arran, then across to the Cumbrae's, walk back to Largs, have your tea. Wonderful. That would be great. Just think about it. No waiting for ferries, no going on boats. And to me, that just sounds absolutely wonderful. You see, sailing has never really been my thing. One of the only times that I was on a sailboat was when I was about 15. And I was in the Scouts at the time, and one of the activities was to go sailing. And it was just a small sailboat on a large loch. I think it was in Fife somewhere, I can't quite remember. Needless to say, it didn't go well. It was just a small sailing boat, and somehow I managed to sink it. And even worse was the fact that I managed to sink the boat even before it had left the jetty. I managed to topple the boat over, and it filled with water and capsized. So that wasn't a great experience of sailing. And anyone who knows me also knows that I don't do very well on rough seas. I get really, really seasick. And so, in my opinion, the sea is for looking at and enjoying looking at, but land is there to stand upon. You cannot beat a bit of terra firma. Now today, we see this great miracle in Matthew 14 of Jesus walking on the water. And we then see the amazing way that Peter joins him walking on the water. Now, if you remember the context, you remember last week we saw Jesus feeding an enormous crowd. 5,000 men besides women and children. So maybe 10,000, 15,000 people. And Jesus fed them with only 5 loaves and 2 fish. And after the crowd has eaten their fill and the 12 baskets have been filled up with the broken pieces left over. Now today we see in Matthew chapter 14 the miracle of Jesus walking on the water and the amazing way that Peter joins him walking on the water also. Now if you remember the context, remember last week that we saw Jesus feeding an enormous crowd. 5,000 men besides women and children. So perhaps a crowd of, I don't know, 10,000, 15,000 people. And Jesus feeds them with only 5 loaves and 2 fish. And we see in our passage today that after the crowd has eaten and the 12 baskets of leftover food have been collected, that Jesus then makes the disciples go back into the boat to take it to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus himself dismisses the crowd and then goes up a mountainside to pray. Now remember here that following John the Baptist's death and following Herod's threats, that Jesus has been seeking some solitude, which of course prompted the journey in the first place over the Sea of Galilee. But remember how when he reached the other side that there was this huge crowd like sheep without a shepherd, and so Jesus ministered to the people. So obviously with the crowd being there, Jesus had no time to be alone. But now, after the disciples are in the boat and the crowd has been dismissed, finally Jesus has some alone time, and he has some time and an opportunity to pray. You see, now that John the Baptist had gone, this was a really key time for Jesus in his ministry. And just after this time, this time of prayer, we see this being a really key time where Jesus begins a kind of ministry to the Gentiles, and then, of course, he sets his face to the cross. So I hope that we see that this is a kind of time of transition, and Jesus is coming closer to doing what he's ultimately come to do, which is to go to the cross at Calvary. Now, just as a first point this morning, it's really important that in the same way that Jesus spent time in solitude with his Father, that we too spend some time alone with God in prayer. At the moment, as I said in our intimations, we have a banner outside the church that says, "Try praying." Why? Because we believe in prayer. We believe in seeking after God. We believe that God is able to speak into our situations and into our lives. And if Jesus prayed and he was God's Son, then we too ought to pray. And I would encourage you, if you've never prayed before or never truly prayed, then try picking up a Try Praying booklet from the church. And if you do pray, well, why not use the Catching the Way 40 Days of Prayer during this time of Lent, as many in the church are doing. The details of that are in the latest church email or on the Facebook page. So I want you to notice, first of all, Jesus spends time alone and he prays. It's a good pattern for us to follow. Now, at the same time as Jesus is praying on the mountaintop, at the very same time, we see the disciples in the boat, trying to get to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. Now, the Sea of Galilee is about 7 miles across at its broadest point. And in 9 to 12 hours, the disciples had only managed to make it maybe 3-4 miles across the lake. Why? Because the sea, the wind was against them. And so they've been struggling for hours and hours and hours trying to get across to the other side of the lake. And they are buffeted about by the waves. And so now, by this time, Jesus has been praying on the mountaintop. The disciples are in the middle of the lake. And early in the morning, after the disciples have been on the lake for hours and hours, just before dawn, the disciples see something. Or rather, they see someone on the water. And they see this figure walking on the water. Now, let's not be too harsh on the disciples here. They had been up all night. They'd been, you know, rowing away on this boat most likely. And they see this figure walking on the water. Now, who does that? Who walks on water? Have you ever seen someone walking on water? Me neither. I haven't seen anyone do that. It's therefore no wonder that the disciples think that they see a ghost, because to them there is no other explanation. And they cry out in fear. I think we would have done exactly the same. But Jesus doesn't make them wait and wonder, does he? He immediately says to them, and it's interesting, immediately is a word that's repeated 3 times in this passage. Immediately he says to them, "Take courage, it is I, don't be afraid." So immediately Jesus wants to reassure the disciples. But Peter, and of course it had to be Peter, Peter is really the spokesman, the foreman, if you like, of the disciples, the one who's always, you know, putting his is footing it often, but he's always the one who's foremost out of all the disciples. He wants more proof that this is Jesus. And you have to admire Peter's faith, don't you? Because Peter says, Lord, if it's you, tell me to come to you on the water. Now, perhaps surprisingly, Jesus takes up that challenge and he says to Peter, come. Now, to be fair to Peter, and I don't know if I would be the same in his situation, Peter swings his legs over the side of the boat and he goes for it and he walks on the water. I'm not sure that I would have been so brave. As the book title of the famous book by John Ortberg goes, if you want to walk on the water, you've got to get out of the boat. And that's exactly what Peter does. And Peter shows great faith. Great faith, especially when you think of the strength of the wind, when you think of the waves that are probably buffeting the boat as well. Peter gets out of the boat, and amazingly, he begins to walk on the water. Can you imagine? But then something happens. Because when Peter sees the wind, Peter is afraid. And he begins to sink. Before, he was walking along as he kept his eyes fixed on Jesus. But then he sees the wind. Now, of course, we can't see the wind, can we? We, of course, feel the wind, but we know exactly what's happening here, don't we? You see, when Peter first goes over the edge of the boat in his excitement, it seems to me that he's got his eyes fixed on Jesus. But then his attention is taken away from Jesus and he's fixated on the wind and he begins to doubt. And as he doubts, what happens? He begins to sink. And he has to call out to Jesus as he's sinking, Lord, save me. And immediately, that word again, Jesus reaches out his hand and catches him and says, you have little faith. Why did you doubt? And together they walk in the water once more back to the boat. And when they get back into the boat, then the wind dies down. Now, this is such a familiar story to us, isn't it? But there are a couple of things that I want you to notice this morning. The first thing, I want you to notice what this tells us about Jesus. Because this story tells us that Jesus has power over nature and that he truly is the Son of God. I love what Charles Price says about this, because he says, that which threatened to be over Peter's head, i.e. the water, was under Jesus' feet. And I love that. You see, we know that it should not be possible to walk on the water. Physics tells us that that is not possible for humans. But of course, Jesus is more than human. Jesus is divine. Nothing is impossible for him. Everything, even the waves on the sea, are under his feet. It's no wonder then that when Jesus and Peter get back into the boat, the disciples worship Jesus and declare him, for the first time, the Son of God, the Messiah. You see, this is a mighty display of Jesus' power and who he is. And the disciples recognize this, that no one else could do this. And they bow down and they worship. And when we understand who Jesus is, then that's what we are called to do too. And what we cannot help doing. As we understand that Jesus is divine, we can only bow the knee and worship him. You see, over the last few weeks, we've seen different reactions to Jesus, haven't we? The people of Nazareth, Jesus' hometown, who rejected Jesus. Herod, who beheaded John, and in time would reject Jesus too. The crowds, who were like sheep without a shepherd, and yet who found in Jesus a true shepherd. The disciples, who on a boat in the middle of the Sea of Galilee see Jesus' divine power, declare him to be the Son of God, and who bow down and worship him. Now, what I want you to notice is that Jesus always demands a response. We cannot just sit on the fence when it comes to Jesus. We have to make a response to him. What is a response to Jesus this morning? Jesus shows he's divine. Do you believe that? Are you willing to bow the knee? The second thing I want you to notice this morning is about Peter. Peter, in this passage, exercises faith. And in our lives, there are times when we too are called to exercise faith. Now, interestingly here, Peter volunteers, doesn't he? When the disciples see Jesus on the water and they think he's a ghost, you know, Peter's looking for proof. Jesus, if that's really you, then call me out to be with you. In many ways, that seems a kind of foolish thing. It's therefore surprising that Jesus says to Peter, come. But what we need to notice is that faith is never forced. Peter volunteers. Jesus says, come. And so Peter goes. And he swings his legs over the side of the boat and he goes walking on the water. Of course, it's when he stops focusing on Jesus and focuses on the strength of the wind that the problems come. And that can happen in our lives too, that we become focused on the problems in our life rather than upon the one who's greater than all our problems. And look what happens to Peter. You see, when he takes his eyes off Jesus, he begins to sink. Because he's focused upon the wind, he's focused upon the problem, he's scared. But even when he's scared, even during those times when he doubts, what happens? Jesus reaches out, catches him, and then walks with him. And in our lives, I believe that God never gives us more than we can cope with. And in those times when we call out to God because we're almost overwhelmed, we can trust that when we call, Jesus will answer. And there's another thing I want you to notice here also. You see, what I want you to notice here is, when did the wind die down? You see, what was Peter afraid of? He was afraid of the wind when he's walking on the water. When did the wind die down? It was only when Jesus and Peter got back into the boat. Now, what we need to realize is that Jesus could have calmed the sea, could have calmed the wind long before if he wanted to. He could have calmed it from the mountaintop. It would have been no problem for him. He's already calmed a sort of storm if we know Matthew chapter 8. It would have been easier, you would have thought, for Peter to walk on the water when it was all calm, when there was no wind. In some ways, sometimes we want life to be smooth and to be easy. But sometimes we have to exercise faith when things are tough, when the wind is blowing and the waves are all around us. It seems much harder then, isn't it? To exercise faith when things are not easy, and to trust even in the difficulty that Jesus is right there with us. So I want you to notice that Peter had to endure the wind and the waves. He had to trust Jesus, and all the way through, Jesus was there with him. And even during the difficulty, Jesus walked beside him and brought him back to the safety of the boat. And maybe in your situation today, when the waves are threatening to overwhelm you, you just need to know that Jesus is right there. And even during those times when it feels as though you're sinking, Jesus is just a handbreadth away. You just need to call out to him and trust he's there. So I want you to notice in our passage today, Jesus is divine. All nature is in his hands, and the disciples worship him. And we too are called to worship. I want you to see Peter, the one who exercises faith, even in spite of the wind and the waves. And we too, in our lives, are often called to exercise faith. And when Peter's faith falters and he calls out, Jesus is right there to save him. And we too can be assured when we call out to Jesus in our time of need, he will be there for us. You see, we're never promised that life will be easy, that life will always be smooth and calm. But when we call out, Jesus is right there with us. And the very last thing this morning, Jesus and the disciples landed at Gennesaret, very likely blown off course. That's probably not really where they should have landed, but because of the wind, that's where they ended up. But of course, Jesus is never blown off course, is he? The people, as they land, recognize Jesus, and Jesus responds to their faith by healing them. Even those who touched the edge of his robes were healed. You see, it's no coincidence that Jesus ends up there. There are no coincidences with God. Today in your life, perhaps Jesus is asking you to exercise faith. What will you do? Will you remain in the boat? Will you be frightened by the wind? Or will you, like Peter, despite his faith ended up being faltering faith, will you go? Will you swing your legs over the side of the boat and walk on the water, disregarding the wind and the waves, looking towards Jesus, trusting that despite the things that threaten to go over your head, that Jesus truly does have everything under his feet, and we can always trust him. Shall we just join together in prayer? Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for this familiar passage today that speaks into our hearts and our minds. We thank you that it tells us that Jesus is no ordinary man, but he is the Son of God, the one who is divine, that even nature responds to him. We thank you, Lord God, that the disciples recognized this, and they bowed down and they worshipped him and declared that he was and is the Son of God. And in our lives, Lord God, as we understand who Jesus is, we pray that we would be willing to bow the knee before him. Lord God, we thank you also for the faith that Peter exercises. We thank you for the way that he was willing to swing his legs over the edge of the boat and to walk on the water. And we pray that we might be like Peter, that we would be people of faith, and that we would fix our eyes upon Jesus. And Lord God, we recognize a bit like Peter. Sometimes we're overwhelmed by our problems. Peter being overwhelmed by the wind and the waves, and he begins to sink. And sometimes in our own lives, faith feels a bit like that as we doubt. We take our eyes off Jesus. Lord God, may we understand that Jesus is reaching out his hand to us, and we simply need to trust in him. And no matter what we're going through in our lives, we will never be overwhelmed, because Jesus is the one who walks beside us. He's the one who supports us. He's the one who will help us through. So, loving Lord God, we ask that you would speak to us through your word today, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord God, we are grateful that we can draw near to you in prayer. We thank you that you are the sovereign Lord who holds all things in his hands, that you are the God in whom we can trust. Lord God, we recognize with what's happening in our world and in our nation at this time that sometimes we can feel overwhelmed. We can be worried about what's going on. We still see many people in hospital, many people in our nation losing their lives because of COVID-19. But we thank you, Lord God, that we can trust that all things are in your hands and everything is under your feet. You know the beginning from the end, and we can always trust in your will and in your ways. Heavenly Father, as we come to you this day, we pray especially for those who have been affected by this pandemic, those who have lost loved ones, those who remain in hospital, those who have really suffered because of the restrictions, with loneliness or mental health issues. And we ask, Lord God, that you would be with them. We do remember those who are on the front line. We remember our key workers. We remember those in the NHS. And we ask that you would guard them and watch over them. We thank you for the light at the end of the tunnel that we do have. And we thank you for the vaccine program that has been rolled out in such an efficient manner. And we pray that that would continue. And although there might be issues with supply in the weeks to come, we ask that those who are most vulnerable would receive the vaccine that they need. Heavenly Father, as we come before you, we also want to remember our leaders at this time. We pray for the First Minister and the Scottish Government, that you will lead them and guide them in all the decisions that they make. We remember the government at Westminster also. And again, we ask that you would give them your guidance, your wisdom, and your help. Heavenly Father, as we pray for this particular situation, we also want to pray for our world at this time. We remember there are many places which continue to suffer because of COVID-19, but also there is continued suffering around the world because of inequality and injustice. There are many people who are suffering because of corrupt government, many people who are suffering because of natural disaster. And we pray, Lord God, that you would be merciful. We continue to pray for the situation in Myanmar. We pray for the situation in the Middle East, in places like Syria, where there is often violence. And we pray for other places where there is famine, where people do not have clean water to drink or proper medical provision. And we pray, Lord God, that our world would be a fairer place. We thank you for organizations which are working on the ground, helping to alleviate the suffering of the poor in particular. Organizations like Christian Aid and Tear Fund, we ask that you would help them and resource them in every way. Heavenly Father, we pray for the church at this time. We thank you for the worldwide body of the church of which we are a part. And we particularly remember our brothers and sisters where they are persecuted for their faith in you. Lord God, may you sustain them and watch over them at this time. We also pray for the church in our own nation. We recognize this is a difficult and a challenging time for the church. And we pray for the wider church in Scotland, that you would bless your church and you would revive your church once more. We pray for the Church of Scotland, and we ask that you would bless the Church of Scotland in all its parts, and that, Lord God, you would bless the church where your name is lifted high and glorified. Heavenly Father, we are grateful that nothing is hidden from you. And as we come before you this day, we are grateful that we can lay our prayers before your throne of grace. We thank you that you know us intimately, that you know everything about us. And therefore, as we come before you this day, Lord God, we lift our own situation before you. If we are struggling in our own health, with our physical health or mental health or spiritual health, we ask that you would continue to be with us, that your hand of healing and wholeness would be upon us. We pray for our own situation if we're struggling in terms of our job situation, whether we're worried about our job or being unemployed, whether we're worried about being on furlough. We ask that you would guide us and lead us. We remember those we know who are struggling with family problems, those who are struggling with financial issues, and we ask that you would be close beside them at this time. We pray, Lord God, that as your hands and feet here on earth, that you would help us and lead us and guide us to the places where we should be and to the people that you would have us minister to. So, Heavenly Father, we ask that you would hear all these our prayers this day, and you would answer them in accordance with your will. For we pray these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Now, as always, a big thank you for joining us for our service this morning. Please do remember our 4 o'clock Zoom service for families and then our 6:50 reflection this evening. And as always, if you need anything from the Manson, please feel free to get in touch with me. My details are on the church website and also on the latest email that we sent out just on Wednesday past. But let's finish our service this morning with the blessing. And now may the peace which passes all understanding guard your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen.